The NBA is an environment filled with a lot of ego, pressure to win, and pressure to make money. There's a lot of confrontation in the job description, and sooner or later, any locker room can turn into a bunch of wild bulls butting their heads. Here are the 10 stupidest, craziest, and most violent locker room incidents in NBA history. Gilbert Arenas bringing a gun. NBA players spend a lot of time on planes, and they like to gamble and play cards to pass time, especially before the smartphone era. A card game called Bouray is among the all-time favorites, and it has been for years. Washington Wizards of the late aughts weren't the exception to the rule, and during one play of Bouray, things got heated. Tavares Crittenden had just lost a game in favor of JaVale McGee and demanded a rematch. The only problem was that the plane was already landing, which meant the game was over. Crittenden started shouting and cursing, and Gilbert Arenas had heard enough. Many foul words and several death threats later, the plane landed, and things have calmed down, but only for a while. The next time they all got to the locker room, Arenas brought four guns, asking Crittenden which one he should use to shoot him. What he didn't count on was that Tavares came prepared, with a loaded gun of his own. Soon enough, the Wizards' locker room looked like a Western movie. What was supposed to be a joke turned into a standoff, and nobody was waiting around to check for the joke to be over. Almost all the Wizards without a gun scattered from the locker room, and the word got out that two NBA players are possibly going to shoot each other. Police had to intervene, and the NBA officials soon found out. Because of their stupidity, both Tavares and Gilbert were suspended for the rest of the season. Kenyon Martin's car getting filled with popcorn. One of the most memorable scenes in Clint Eastwood's 2008 movie Gran Torino is when he said this badass line. Ever notice how you come across somebody once in a while you shouldn't have f***ed with? There are certain NBA players with whom you don't want to step any lines. In the 80s, it was Charles Oakley, Bill Laimbeer, and Charles Barkley. In the 90s, it was Rodman or Kevin Garnett. In the early 2000s, it was Steven Jackson, both Rasheed and Ben Wallace, and Ron Artest. Kenyon Martin, the first pick of the 2000 NBA draft, was in that group as well, and he wasn't somebody you wanted to mess with. However, J.R. Smith, a beautiful spirit that he always was, didn't think those rules applied to him. During their time with the Nuggets, J.R. decided that it would be funny if he filled up Kenyon's car with popcorn, a prank that has been played out in the NBA, and it's mostly done to rookies when they buy their first expensive car. It was not something a young player should have done to a veteran, especially not to someone who made a career out of being tougher and meaner than his opponents, like Kenyon Martin. It was a big mistake, and JR was soon really, really sorry. But because Kenyon was such a hothead, JR couldn't have been sorry enough. Martin wanted a piece of him, and he wanted it bad. He was going to turn Smith into chopped liver, if only he could have gotten his hands on him. Thankfully, the Nuggets GMs and coaches knew who they were dealing with, and they begged Kenyon not to tear him a new one. The team paid for his car, and the cooler heads prevailed. Amari Stoudemire punches through the glass. Amari Stoudemire's New York career started with a bang in 2010. He scored 30 or more in 9 straight games and got selected to the All-Star game. And then the team added Carmelo Anthony, and everything looked peachy. But because they gave up a lot of body parts for another V12 engine in Carmelo, the Knicks didn't have enough depth to compete in the playoffs, and got swept by the Celtics in the first round. Next season, it was much of the same. The Knicks had lofty expectations with two superstars, but they gave up so much in that Carmelo trade, and it wasn't easy to build a good supporting cast around them. They finished 7th in the East, which secured them a date with LeBron James and the Miami Heat in the first round of the playoffs. The Heatles made easy work of the Knicks in Game 1, winning the game by 33 points. Following another loss in Game 2, Amari was fuming, sick of constant playoff disappointments, and Amari couldn't contain his anger, so he punched the glass casing surrounding a fire extinguisher on his way to the locker room. He was forced to miss Game 3 with lacerations on his hands, and even though he came back for the rest of the series with his hand wrapped, the series was a wrap too, and the Knicks couldn't recover after a 3-0 deficit. Dennis Rodman and Carmen Electra getting romantic. Doing the dance with no pants in the workplace is a fantasy of many people. There is a certain appeal to getting naughty in the office when everybody is away and then coming back in the morning with great memories, while nobody else has a clue about your mischief. And when your office is an NBA arena, then that deed may have an even bigger appeal to it. Dennis Rodman certainly thought so, and he brought Carmen Electra to his place of work to christen the house. The wild couple enjoyed their romance in the Bulls' locker room and on the court of their practice facility, benefiting from the lesser use of security cameras in the 90s. Somebody could have made a lot of money if those tapes existed, I'll tell you that much. J.R. Smith throwing a bowl of soup at his coach. J.R. Smith was a habitual line stepper during his time in the NBA. He had many facepalm moments ever since he stepped his foot in the league. and became a laughingstock around the world for his endeavors. Other than putting popcorn in people's cars, he got fined for repeatedly untying opponent's shoelaces at the free throw line. He left the court during live action to dap an opponent. And oh, he forgot the score during the last seconds of the NBA Finals. But arguably, the worst thing he ever did happened during his time with the Cavaliers, when he got into an argument with an assistant coach, Damon Jones, and decided to throw a bowl of soup in his face. Luckily, Smith likes his soup lukewarm, so Jones didn't get burnt, but it still earned JR a one-game suspension from the team. Chris Paul taking a secret tunnel. Chris Paul's days in Los Angeles ended on a sour note. His and Blake Griffin's Clippers never got past the second round of the playoffs, so CP decided to look for greener pastures and signed a max deal in Houston in 2017. During his first game against his former team, things got zesty on the floor. There was still obviously a lot of friction between CP3 and certain Clippers, namely Blake Griffin and Austin Rivers. And then, for reasons still unknown and still extremely hard to believe, CP3 led James Harden and Trevor Ariza through the secret hallway in the Staples Center that led straight to the Clippers' locker room. The fellas tried to explain a few more things to their colleagues on the Clippers. We can call it a scuffle, a kerfuffle, a skirmish, but these guys weren't really trying to fight each other. However, the police were called, and the story went viral. Charles Barkley and Shaquille O'Neal nearly suffocated from laughter on Inside the NBA, mocking these modern softies who didn't have the human decency to fight it out as they did in their playing days. Latrell Sprewell choking his coach. Latrell Sprewell is known for several things. The first one was his all-star basketball career, especially his stint with the Knicks and the trip to the 1999 NBA Finals. The second one was his famous rejection of a three-year, $21 million contract with the phrase, "I've got to feed my family," after which he never played in the NBA again. But what is Sprewell most famous for has got to be the choking of PJ Carlesimo. This happened in 1997. Spree was on the Warriors, and Carlesimo was the head coach. PJ asked Latrell to try harder in practice, and Sprewell wasn't in a good mood. Coach then asked for crisper passing, nudging his star player to put a little more mustard on his passes. I don't know if he was allergic to mustard or something, but once he heard that, Sprewell completely lost his mind and ended up choking Carlesimo out for a good 7-10 seconds before the other players dragged him away from the coach. Sprewell marched to the locker room, but he decided to give another go at Coach Carlesimo, and this time, he tried to punch him in the face. The Warriors voided the remainder of his $24 million contract, and the NBA suspended him for 1 year. Carmelo Anthony trying to confront Kevin Garnett. Kevin Garnett was one of the meanest and nastiest trash talkers in NBA history. He wished Tim Duncan a happy Mother's Day, knowing well that his mother passed away. He called Charlie Villanueva a cancer patient. Nothing was sacred to Garnett, and he would say anything to get his opponents focused on his words and not on their game. In January of 2013, in a game between Garnett's Celtics and Melo's Knicks, Garnett succeeded with his trash talk and got Carmelo totally riled up. KG supposedly said that Anthony's wife Lala tasted like Honey Nut Cheerios, and Melo wanted to fight him right then and there. But because the NBA is not the NHL, there are no real fights on the floor anymore like they were in the 80s and the 90s. So, Carmelo said that he'll be waiting for KG after he comes out of the locker room and before he enters the bus. But this was in the heat of the moment, and everything cooled off post-game, and their fight never happened. Chris Mills trying to fight Bonzi Wells. What Carmelo failed to do with KG, Chris Mills sure didn't with Bonzi Wells in 2002. It all started during a game between the Warriors and the Trailblazers, as Mills threw a punch at Wells during a brawl that started after the final buzzer. But that one punch didn't satisfy his appetite for aggression, and Mills went to the Blazers' locker room for some more of Bonzi Wells. After he was restrained from coming inside the locker room, Mills tracked down the Blazers' bus, and he and a few of his friends parked a car in front of it and challenged the Blazers for round two of the fight. He got a three-game suspension for this. Matt Barnes chasing John Henson to the locker room. Matt Barnes and Steven Jackson's podcast is called All the Smoke for a Reason. These fellas want all the smoke, both literally and figuratively. There ain't no messing around with these two. While Stack's highlight reel includes chasing fans during the famous Malice at the Palace, Matt Barnes learned from it, and he only chased another NBA player. Bucks big man John Henson blocked Barnes' shot with 5 seconds left in the game, and then screamed and celebrated in his face. As you can imagine, Barnes was pissed off and got into Henson's face, and both players got a technical. When the final whistle sounded, Barnes tried to chase Henson down and followed him down the tunnel. Matt then entered the Bucks locker room searching for Henson, but thankfully, the things didn't escalate from there.